Yo, Future, so my good mate Tristan just put me onto this awesome blog post by one of the co-founders of Coinbase, and he's talking about app coins, and it's basically everything we've been discussing for the past 2 years. So whenever you're launching any type of platform that involves a marketplace, like has two-sided marketplace, or if you're launching some type of social network where you need user interaction and user content generation to make it work, then you inevitably run into the chicken and egg problem. Basically, you need, so just in a social network, say something like Reddit, obviously you need users posting content to make the site interesting to build a community. Without one, you don't have the other. Same issue with something like an Etsy or an eBay or literally any type of marketplace where you have two sides. You have like buyers and sellers, or someone offering something and someone like buying something, some exchange. And typically these marketplaces, these social networks require many, many years of like concerted effort and grind to get them to the point where they actually like run themselves. And so that takes a lot of capital. So typically you've got to get these platforms, these marketplaces up to a point where they're actually showing promise and showing demand and showing user growth. Then you need to get investment to last the years it'll take to get them to a sustainable point. And I mean, the moment you get investors, you're not in control anymore. You're under a hierarchy. You're under an umbrella. You're literally working to make the investors money. They want to see return on their investment. And as a result, we end up in this situation where there's massive, giant, monopolistic hierarchies. Think of like Uber, Airbnb, Facebook, all these companies are basically profiting off their users. Like, why is Facebook worth $300 billion when really it's all just user-generated content? The users are the one doing the work. They're the ones that have the value. Why aren't they getting paid any of that money? Think of Uber. If Uber is literally just like a person with a car offering a person who needs a ride, why is Uber in the middle making billions and billions of dollars of profit for their founders and investors? So now there's blockchain developer platforms where you can actually create a cryptocurrency and then incentivize the user behaviors you want on those platforms, as well as sharing in the profit and giving equity to all of your users. And even before the Ethereum crowd sale, myself and Tristan were talking about this as the exact use case we'd want to use. We've always wanted to build these massive hive minds, these massive platforms, and this is the perfect way. So Steemit is a great example. They're not built on Ethereum. They've decided to do their own thing for some reason. But the way they work is they have a cryptocurrency called Steem and a very complicated system. So the front end of Steem, it looks like pretty much like Reddit. You post content, you upload, downvote, you comment, but you actually earn some of the Steem dollars for doing each of those actions. And now this Steem dollar, this Steem power, it's a cryptocurrency, it's floating, it actually has a value. I think last I checked, it was somewhere between one Steem dollar is worth $1 to $2, somewhere between. And so when Steem built out the platform, they started with a base of zero. Like the Steem dollar would have been worth nothing, but because people are speculating on the value going up, they post content. And so in that way, you can actually use this cryptocurrency to basically incentivize the exact user behaviors you want in order to get that flywheel spinning, to get the two-sided marketplace going. And what they did and what most people do is they basically have a crowd sale where the coins are worth nothing, they're not minted yet, but you can buy in and buy some from there and get in on the very ground. You know, it's like an investment, it's like crypto equity. And so what that trend means is you can start these giant marketplaces, these giant protocols, these giant like economies from scratch and basically solve the chicken and egg problem because you've got one side sorted. And you don't need investors because you're basically crowdfunding crypto equity. And so all your users, all the people who support and believe in that mission, they're kind of bought into it. They own a part of it. So when Steem had actually launched on the blockchain, I think they operated before that, but when they actually launched, they went from zero to over $200 million as their market cap within 4 months. So do you remember when the App Store, when the Apple App Store, when the Android App Store, when they first launched, there was basically like a gold rush. Everyone was like, holy shit, I can make tons of money off apps. I'm going to make an app. I'm going to put it on the store. Within the next few years, there's going to be a dApp rush. So dApp stands for decentralized app, and that's what these things are. They're decentralized app, they're smart contracts, they're pieces of code that run on the blockchain and can never be shut down. The funny thing is, though, people are going to attack this. When they start seeing there's so much money in this system and people are like doing these crowd sales and making tons of money, most of the startup cliche mindset people are going to come in wanting to make profit. But by design, the way these blockchain developer platforms work is that they basically drive everything towards zero cost, towards zero marginal cost, because all the code is open and public and copyable. If you make a dApp and charge a 10% transaction fee, well, if people think that's too much, they can literally just copy-paste your code, set it to 0% fee, and then deploy it, and now it's running as usual. I mean, you'll still be able to have like charge fees in these things, but you just have to do it in a very intelligent way where, you know, it's not about hoarding wealth, it's not about the typical capitalistic drive anymore. I think we'll start to see more of a cooperative kind of collective drive in capitalism. Startups won't be this thing where you're like going to make shitloads of money and be the hierarchy and make a $1 billion company, no. It pulls the whole startup scene back to what it's originally meant to be, its original purpose, its underlying mission, which is to add value to humanity and bring power back to the people. And the reason why this movement won't be a fad and it won't fade away is because of the way blockchains are designed by nature. Quite literally, they can never, ever be shut down, ever. when you deploy your code, first of all, you don't need permission to deploy it, like the App Store or the Android Store. Like, you don't need that. You can deploy it at any time without asking anyone. And secondly, when you deploy a dApp, it's not hosted on any server where the government can come and find it and shut it down, or if you stop paying your web hosting bill, they shut it down. No, it's distributed across an entire network. These platforms are so resilient that they will basically last as long as the internet. The internet's never been shut down. I mean, you can shut down half of it, the other half still runs. So these dApps will run well beyond your death. So if you're looking to build a legacy, these dApps, these protocols, these decentralized business models, these economies, whatever we end up calling them, they're way more resilient than even the biggest companies on the planet. As an example, only 14% of the Fortune 500 companies of the last 60 years are still around. So 86% of them have failed and no longer exist. And sure, like 99.9% of the dApps will fail, just like any startup, just like any project, but the, you know, the ones that do succeed will be the ones that actually give so much value and power back to humanity. I think it'll be the dApps, the smart contracts, the economies, the protocols that give the most value back to humanity at zero cost and automate all the inefficiencies and redundancies in our world. These big dApps will essentially become like way more foundational than even our infrastructure, you know, more resilient than roads and the electricity grid, than the sewage system, than the water pipe. If software is eating the world, like Mark Andreessen says, then dApps will essentially eat all of the hierarchies, all of the centralization structures, and decentralize everything and give power back to the people. It'll be like taking every single hierarchy, every single pyramidal structure, every single centralized institutional organization, and all the exploitation that comes with that, and just demolishing it. The end game will be like a decentralized, distributed operating system for society where the rules and the procedures and the equality is coded into the system. And so how does a global society change when, like, a kid in Africa literally has the exact same power as the president of the United States or a billionaire when that's coded into the system? It's often been said that these blockchain platforms are really going to bring about a global consciousness, like wake up the internet, because really what you're doing, a dApp is kind of like, it's like creating a neural pathway. It's always going to exist. Our brain is a decentralized network of 100 billion neurons, but there are specific sections and specific neural pathways that actually do certain functions. And that's kind of what dApps and smart contracts will do. And by nature of these blockchain developer platforms, these dApps can actually be interconnected with each other. They're not sitting in isolation. They're all interconnected. They can all talk to each other and they all understand each other's code. When electrical activity goes into the brain, it basically causes a cascading fractal neural pathway where every neuron can basically talk to each other. This is exactly what dApps will do. DApps will all talk to each other and all connect. And then the cool thing is, if dApps are actually able to read each other's code and they're aware of it, they become these self-aware collective entities where if one change happens in one dApp, the others can rewrite their code to suit. You can maybe think of that as like kind of building brain plasticity, neural plasticity into the internet itself and the fabric of society globally. So if you think the world is broken, you want to make a change, you want to see everyone have equal opportunity and equal say and equal power and, you know, fix the system essentially. It's not about capitalism versus communism versus socialism versus conservatism versus liberalism versus libertarianism. It's none of those. There's a bigger thing at play and there's only one thing at play. So don't worry about protests, don't worry about petitions, don't worry about the economy, don't worry about any of those other labels, and don't worry about politics at all. So grab a laptop and code a dApp, because the only ideological war that matters is centralism versus decentralism, and right now, the greatest change to the fabric of humanity has just begun at Future.